welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear stories from Brian Lynn and John Russell. Mario Ritter Jr. presents this week's Education Report. We close the show with the Lesson of the Day from Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins. But first, here is Brian Lynn.
Scientists in Brazil say heavy rains helped them discover a fossil they believe came from one of the world's oldest dinosaurs. Researchers found the fossil in May in Brazil's southern state of Rio Grande do Sul. They said the fossilized bones make up nearly a complete dinosaur skeleton. A leader of the team, paleontologist Rodrigo Temp Mueller, said the fossil is believed to be about 233 million years old. It was discovered next to a body of water in the area of São João do Polesne. Mueller is with Brazil's Federal University of Santa Maria in Rio Grande do Sul. He said heavy rains in the area had helped speed up the natural process of erosion that led to the discovery. Fossils are more likely to get exposed after rains because water washes away the dirt that covers them. Details of the discovery have not yet been confirmed by other scientists or published in any scientific publications. The researchers believe the dinosaur lived during the Triassic period. The first dinosaurs are thought to have appeared at that time after Earth's largest mass extinction event about 252 million years ago. During the Triassic period, all continents were part of a single landmass called Pangaea. The team thinks the dinosaur belonged to a group known as Hererosauridae. A document received by the Associated Press explains this family of creatures once lived on land that now makes up present-day Brazil and Argentina. The document said the size of the bones suggests the dinosaur would have been around 2.5 meters long. After about 4 days of excavation work, researchers transported a large piece of rock containing the fossil back to their laboratory. There, they carried out tests. At first, Mueller said he thought the team had only collected a few isolated bones. But after detailed testing, the researchers said they had almost a complete skeleton. Mueller told the AP his team was very excited and surprised by the discovery. He said the new find might be the second most complete skeleton found for this kind of dinosaur. The researchers are carrying out studies to see whether the fossil belongs to an already known species or a new kind. The effort is expected to take several months. Brazil's Rio Grande do Sul state reported record rainfall earlier this year. Officials said the rain caused widespread flooding in May that led to at least 182 deaths. Some weather experts say climate change makes extreme weather events more likely. They say the burning of oil, gas, and coal affects the climate. Mueller said other fossils appeared after the heavy rains. He noted these finds had launched a race against time to rescue the materials before they are ruined. For example, team members in the field said they had observed what appeared to be a leg bone and a pelvis bone. But they said these were in danger of being destroyed because of the rain. Mueller hopes the new discovery can help further explain the origins of dinosaurs. Having new fossils that are so well preserved certainly helps us better understand this topic that is still much debated, he said. I'm Brian Lynn.
An advocacy group for Indigenous peoples has released images of a reclusive Peruvian Amazon tribe's members searching for food outside of their usual area. The group calls the pictures evidence that industrial tree-cutting operations are dangerously close to the tribe's territory. The industry is also known as logging. The group, Survival International, said the photographs and video it posted recently show members of the Mashco Piro looking for food near the community of Monte Salvado on the Las Piedras River in Madre de Dios. Several logging companies hold timber agreements inside territory the tribe lives in, Survival International says. The group has long worked to protect what it says is the largest uncontacted tribe in the world. The nearness of logging operations raises fears of conflict between loggers and tribal members, as well as the possibility that loggers could bring dangerous disease to the Mashco Piro, the group said. Two loggers, one of whom died, were shot with arrows while fishing in 2022 in a reported fight with tribal members. Cesar Ipenza is a lawyer who specializes in environmental law in Peru. He is not connected with Survival International. Ipenza said the new images are evidence of a worrying situation because we do not know exactly what is the reason for their departure from the rainforest to the beaches. Isolated indigenous tribes may travel in August to collect turtle eggs to eat, he said. But we also see with great concern that some illegal activity may be taking place in the areas where they live, and lead them to leave and be under pressure, he said. We cannot deny the presence of a logging concession kilometers away from where they live. Survival International called for the Forest Stewardship Council, or FSC, a group that confirms sustainable forestry, to remove its approval of the operations of one of those companies, Peru-based Canales Tawamanu. The FSC responded in a statement that it would do a comprehensive review of the company's operations to ensure it is protecting the rights of indigenous peoples. Canales Tawamanu, also known as Katawa, has said in the past that it is operating with official permission. The company did not immediately answer a message seeking comment on its operations and the tribe. A 2023 report by the United Nations Special Rapporteur on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples said Peru's government had recognized in 2016 that the Mashco Piro and other isolated tribes were using territories that had been opened to logging. The report expressed concern that the territory of indigenous peoples had not been marked out despite reasonable evidence of their presence since 1999. Survival International said the photos were taken June 26th through 27th and show about 53 male Mashco Piro on the beach. The group estimated as many as 100 to 150 tribal members would have been in the area with women and children nearby. "It is very unusual that you see such a large group together," Survival International researcher Teresa Mayo said in a talk with the Associated Press. Ipenza, the lawyer, said indigenous people usually move in smaller groups, and a larger group might be a situation of alarm, even in the case of legal logging. I'm John Russell.
More American states are pushing for cell phone restrictions in high schools. The move comes as teachers say it is a major problem in the classroom. In July, Virginia became the latest in a growing number of U.S. states to restrict cell phone use in public schools. The state's governor, Glenn Youngkin, issued an executive order to establish guidance and policies for local school systems to follow by January. Youngkin's order said, "Studies indicate that students who use their phones during class learn less and achieve lower grades." It also cited an alarming mental health crisis among young people driven by the use of cell phones and social media. Last year, Florida became the first state to restrict the use of cell phones in school. A law that took effect in July requires all Florida public schools to ban student cell phone use during class time and block social media on the school's Wi-Fi. The states of Indiana and Ohio passed their own laws this year. Several others, including Oklahoma, Vermont, and Kansas, have also recently introduced what is being called phone-free schools legislation. New York Governor Kathy Hochul said she will push for legislation to ban cell phone use in the coming legislative session in 2025. In a recent public study, the Pew Research Center reported that 72% of U.S. high school teachers say cell phone distraction is a major problem in the classroom. Teachers report less of a problem with younger students. About 33% of middle school teachers and 6% of elementary school teachers see cell phone use as problematic. The Associated Press, AP, reported that a California teacher complained of students watching Netflix during class. In Maryland, a teacher said students used gambling apps to place bets during the school day. Many educators in the U.S. said students used social media, listened to music, and shopped online during the school day. James Granger is a science teacher at a Los Angeles area high school. He told the AP, "Students used to have an understanding that you aren't supposed to be on your phone in class. Those days are gone." Granger added, "The only solution that works is to physically remove the cell phone from the student." Some students say such policies take away their independence and cut off their main method of communication with family and friends. Opposition also has come from parents who fear being cut off from their kids if there is a school emergency. Jaden Willoughby is a student at Delta High School in rural Utah. He shares the concern about being out of contact with his parents if there is an emergency. But he also sees the upside, or good result, of turning in his phone at school. At Delta High School, students are required to leave their phones at the door when entering every class. It helps you focus on your work, and it's easier to pay attention in class, Jaden said. Kim Whitman is a leader of the Phone Free Schools Movement, a group that advises schools. She told the AP she urges educators to make exceptions for students with special educational and medical needs. Back in Virginia, school systems have been increasingly banning or severely restricting students' phone use. For example, Loudoun County Public Schools in Northern Virginia passed a new policy last month that generally bans elementary school students from using phones during the school day. Middle school students are permitted to use their phones before or after school, but they are expected to store their phones in their lockers. In high school, students are expected to silence their phones and place them in storage during instructional time. In Richmond, Virginia, the school system started a cell phone ban last year in some of its high schools and middle schools. Jason Camras is head of the Richmond school system. He said, "We saw more student engagement in class and fewer distractions throughout the day." Additionally, he said, students reported spending more time talking with their peers. I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
Mario Ritter, Jr. joins me now to talk more about this week's education report. Welcome, Mario.
Thank you, Ashley.
First, I was hoping you could explain some of the key vocabulary words we heard in the report. I noticed two words that were especially linked to why some people want cell phone bans in schools.
I believe you would be talking about the terms indicate and cited. Is that right?
Yes, those are the two I noticed. Could you tell us their definition and how to use these two words?
Yes, Ashley. To indicate means to show that something exists. One of the leaders in the report said, "Studies indicate that students who use their phones during class learn less." And cited, a crisis among young people driven by cell phones. To cite means to say where exactly a fact you're using comes from. Very often, when people are talking about problems, they use these terms to say that a problem exists and there is documentation of the problem that people can read on their own.
I noticed another word that has a very different meaning than indicate or cite.
Are you thinking of distraction? The word means to pull a person's attention away from one thing to another, usually that is less important or that has a bad effect.
Great. Well, that's all the time we have for today, Mario. Thanks so much for your report, and thanks for answering my questions.
Thanks for having me on, Ashley.
And now it's time for the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. My name is Jill Robbins, and I'm joined by Andrew Smith. Hi, Andrew.
Hi, Jill.
Our lesson is based on our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Ana Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Ana introducing herself.
Hello, my name is Ana Mateo.
Watching and listening carefully to the video series can help you understand and speak English better.
And learn about some aspects of American culture. For example, Lesson 20 is called The Test Drive. Ana and her friend Penelope go to an auto show. Have you ever been to an auto show, Andrew?
You know, I haven't. I've never been, but I have been interested in going. They look interesting.
In this video, Ana takes a test drive in a car, which means she drives the car for a short distance to try it out. But at auto shows, it's kind of like a fair to demonstrate new models of cars for people interested in learning about them. So you can expect to see new cars and learn about new features. And nowadays, they're really promoting the electric vehicles.
That's right. At this car show, Ana and Penelope are there as reporters. They also mention someone named Rick, who seems to be the videographer.
That's right. Rick created all of the wonderful videos in our first two Let's Learn English series. Let's listen in and find out what Ana and Penelope learn.
Now that's a great idea. Rick, I think we should use this as the opening shot.
Ana, did Miss Weaver give us instructions for covering the car show?
She did. She said that we need to show lots of cars. She said we need to interview people. Okay. And she also said to have fun.
Those were her exact words.
Yeah, she said, have fun, Ana. And she is the boss. Okay, Rick, are you ready? Okay.
Hello, I'm Ana Mateo. Welcome to the Washington Car Show. People all over town are saying that if you like cars, this is the place to be. So let's see what people are talking about.
One of the grammar points in this lesson is reported speech. We hear Ana telling Penelope what Ms. Weaver said.
She said that we need to show lots of cars. She said we need to interview people.
Let's compare how we tell exactly what someone said, like directly, to reporting what they said indirectly. When we quote a person, we give their exact words. Imagine how Ana could directly quote Ms. Weaver.
Ms. Weaver said, "You need to show lots of cars. You need to interview people."
In reported speech, we make some changes. We add a reporting verb, which in our example is the word said. It could also be words such as tell, ask, reply, or any other verbs we use for speech. Then we can use a conjunction like that. The conjunction is optional, as we hear in our examples. Finally, we say the reporting clause, which often uses a different tense from the original. For example, if the verb is present, we might change it to the past. and we may change the pronoun if the, quote, used one. That sounds like a lot of changes, but it's not too complicated. Listen again.
She said that we need to show lots of cars. She said we need to interview people.
Let me give an example where the verb tense changes. Last week, you told me that you were driving to North Carolina for the weekend.
I did. And to report that, you changed the verb tense. I said, I am driving to North Carolina for the weekend.
Yeah, and I would say, Andrew told me that he was driving to North Carolina for the weekend.
Let's listen to one more example from our story. First, Anna tells Penelope that Ms. Weaver told them to have fun. Then, Penelope asks Anna to tell her exactly what Ms. Weaver said.
And she also said, to have fun.
Those were her exact words.
Yeah, she said, have fun, Anna.
I think that's because she didn't quite believe her.
Yeah. Listeners, let's practice this a little bit. Jill and I will say a quote, then give you time to change it to reported speech. Then we'll let you know how it should change. Are you ready?
Yep. Here's the first one. I am going shopping.
Jill said she was going shopping. Or, Jill said she was going to go shopping. Notice the verb changed from am to was. Okay, now it's my turn. I will wash the dishes after lunch.
Andrew said that he would wash the dishes after lunch. Here, the past tense applies to the modal verb will. And the next one. Andrew, will you please make me a cup of tea?
Jill asked me to make her a cup of tea.
Aha! You changed the reporting verb there to ask. Good job!
Jill just said that I did a good job.
Wait, that wasn't an example. I was just saying that.
Well, I guess I'm really on a roll with this reported speech. Now, let's see what happens back at the auto show. I think we're in for some silliness or funny situations, which you can see for yourself if you go to our website and watch the video.
Okay, I think we got good interviews.
Me too. People all had very different opinions, but they all said they loved cars.
Anna,
look!
A robot!
A robot!
A robot.
Rick, we have to use the robot in the show.
What is your first name?
Anna!
Anna?
Anna!
You know, what an effort. What an effort to robot dance. How about a round of applause for Anna? I've never seen anyone try so hard.
Penelope, did you hear that? Hank the robot said that he has never seen anyone dance like me.
I'm sure our listeners can imagine Anna doing that robot dance. And did you notice some more reported speech?
I did. Anna said,
Hank the robot said that he has never seen anyone dance like me.
I bet he hadn't. But now it's time for us to end this podcast.
Andrew said it was time to end the podcast. But you can still practice reported speech. Listen to the radio or TV and take one sentence. Write it or say it to yourself using reported speech.
I think that's a good idea, Jill. Also, our listeners can write to us in an email to learningenglish@voanews.com. Thanks for listening to the lesson of the day. If you liked this program, please share it with your family and friends. And remember that you can also find us on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.